morning, everyone. I am Brother Matthew. Thank you for tuning in once again to listening to our powerful program that is being delivered by our General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye.
Taking away Acts of the Apostles, chapter 16. Acts chapter 16, and the message we're speaking about is the mandate and the ministry of establishing the church. Where the mandate and where the ministry? And that is the mandate and the ministry of the establishment of the church, of those establishing the church. And you look at it in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 16. And I'm looking at verse 1 all through to verse 5. Then came he to Derbe and Lystra. And behold, a certain disciple was there named Timotheus, the son of a certain woman, which was a Jew and believed, but his father was a Greek, which was well reported of by the brethren that were of Lystra and Iconium. Him would all have to go forth for him, and took and circumcised him because of the Jews which were in those quarters. But they all knew that his father was a Greek. And as they went through the cities, they delivered them the decrees for the king, that for each of the apostles and the elders went to Jerusalem. And so were the churches established in the faith and increased in number. Those are the five verses we're looking at today. There's a lot in those verses. For example, to start with, it says, then he came to Derbe. Who is that? That's Paul the Apostle. And why did he come to Derbe? Because he had been there before. Why was he there again? Because in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 15 and verse 35, Paul also and Barnabas continued in Antioch, teaching and preaching the word of the Lord, but many others also. Actually, God had called the Spirit of the Lord as spoken concerning Paul and Barnabas. Separate unto me Paul and Barnabas for the work that have appointed them to. And he went out, and he reached quite a lot of places. And one of those places he reached was Derbe. He also reached Iconium, and he reached Lystra. And it came to the point that he came back to Antioch, where they were sent out. After he came back, it came to the mind of Paul the Apostle. We need to do follow up, and we need to go to the places where we have preached the word of God before. Look at verse 36 of Acts chapter 15. And some days after, Paul said unto Barnabas, let us go again and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord, and see how they do. Let us go and go to all those cities, all those places where we have preached the word of God before. And eventually Barnabas, because of a personal consideration and personal problem that engendered unnecessary discussion, unnecessary disputation, he abandoned the work that the Lord had given him to do with Paul the Apostle. And there are times the Lord has called us to a ministry, and he has called us a work to do. And then we get into unnecessary discussion, unnecessary disagreement, unnecessary disputation, unnecessary contention, and we're not able to do what the Lord has appointed us to do. I thank God for Paul the Apostle. He did not allow a disagreement or disputation or contention or be sidetracked by things that were not essential. He did not allow that to sidetrack him or to disturb him or to deny him of going into the world the Lord had called him to. And therefore the church recommended silence. Look at verse 40 of Acts chapter 15. And Paul chose silence and departed, being recommended by the brethren unto the grace of God. And he went through Syria and Cilicia, confirming the churches. That is, he went through all the places where they had established the church. He was confirming them. He was establishing them. He was encouraging them. He was admonishing them. He was telling them what they ought to do so that they will be strong in the Lord. And that's what the Lord has given us to do. That's what he has called. to you. That's what we call the message, we title the message, the mandate and the ministry of establishing the church. As we look at the ministry of Paul the Apostle going about all of those places to establish the church, what do we see? It is establishing the church and the ministry of believers and of the leaders of the church. They are built in the Word of God. And these can be summarized as number one, exalting Christ. As we establish the church, as we carry out our mandate, as we carry out our ministry, in whatever area we're doing the work, number one, we're exalting Christ. Number two, evangelizing the world. As they went out, Jesus establishing the church, they're also thinking about the world, because Jesus Christ had said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And while we're doing the work in the church, and we're lifting up the church, educating the church, enlightening the church, and strengthening the church, we still continue evangelizing the world. Number three, enlightening the converts. You see, the converts that are one to the law, although they are born again, although they are children of God, they are ignorant. And therefore, we need to teach them the word of God to enlighten the converts. Number four, in defining the church. In fact, the word of God says, it gives some of them apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors, and teachers. Why? For the work of the ministry, and for the defining of the body of Christ. That means then, as we are establishing the church, number one, we're exalting Christ. Number three, we're enlightening the converts. Number four, we're edifying the church. That's what edifying means, build up, to challenge, and to make you grow, and to make steadfast and steady. Edifying the church. Number five, we're equipping believers. Equipping believers. You see, that's what we do. We make the believers to be well equipped. Why are you going to do what? Number one, to witness. Number two, to worship. Number three, to walk, walking with Christ. And then number four, to work. That means to labor. That means then, if we are truly establishing the church, if we are truly carrying out a mandate and ministry, we're equipping the believers to witness, to evangelize, to preach to other people, to reach the lost, so that they can be saved. And we're reaching them and equipping them to worship the Lord in an acceptable manner and to walk with the Lord in the way of righteousness, walking in the Spirit, walking in the light, and walking in love. And then we're also making them to work, to labor in the work of the Lord. Number six, establishing the church. We're planting the churches. We're putting pastors there. We're putting leaders there. We're dividing the house fellowship, and we're putting leaders there. We're increasing the zones and putting leaders there. We're hosting up all the districts and putting leaders there. We're increasing the various regions even, and we're putting overseers there. We're establishing the church. And then number seven, enlarging the church. Enlarging the church. We enlarge the church. We expand the course and the territory of the church. That is the mandate we have. That is the ministry we have. And when we carry out those things, our mandate of ministry, then we will be establishing the church like Paul the Apostle did. We're going to look at 3 points in the message. Number one, the priority of proper training for church edification. The priority of proper training for church edification. Let's go back to Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. And let us see the priority of Paul the Apostle. He was going to all places, and he was going to place of believers, of disciples, so that he could train them. And that should be our priority in the church. The church is not going to go beyond the leaders we train. And when we train more leaders, then we can expand. Then we can plant more churches. We can put your leaders there. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 16, verse 1. Then came he to Derbe and Lystra. And behold, a certain disciple was there, named Timotheus, the son of a certain woman, which was a Jewess, and believed that his father was a Greek, which was well reported by the brethren, that were at Lystra and Iconium, who him with Paul had to go forth with him, and you can circumcise him, because of the Jews which were in those quarters, for they knew all that his father was a Greek. Here we're told from verse 1 that Paul the Apostle came to Derbe and Lystra, And when he came there, it wasn't only preaching. Preaching is wonderful, preaching is good. And we leaders, when we get to a particular place, we want to preach, we ought to preach, we like to preach, and we must preach. But you know, there's something that you still need to do beyond and above that preaching. It's to be very, very observant. It's to look at the Timothys that are there, and look at the Tychuses that are there, and look at the Epaphroditus that is there, and look at all the Tychicus that is there. Look at all the believers that are there. Whom can I resolve? And the zonal leader should have eyes on the zone, members of the zone. Are there Timothys there for me to raise up? Is there a Titus there for me to raise up? And then the leaders of the church, we should have eyes of leaders. And then as we have eyes of leaders, are there some young people there? They are believers already, they are disciples already. And we need to raise them up. And the same thing for a pastor to do. And the same thing for a woman leader to do. And the same thing for an overseer to do. That you have some Timothys there, you're looking for them. It says over here, Timotheus was there. He was a disciple already. That's in verse 1. He was a believer already. That's in verse 1 as well. He believed the Lord. But we notice something about Timothy here. Timothy was not circumcised. That wasn't a big deal. That wasn't any problem at all. Because he was in a Gentile society, in a Gentile place. Because Derbe, Lystra, and all those places were Gentile locations. And being uncircumcised did not matter in all those places. And then Paul the Apostle took him. He wanted to expand his ministry. He wanted to extend his ministry. He wanted to go beyond the Gentile territory and then reach out to the Jewish people. If he's going to reach out to the Jewish people, something must happen in him that had not happened before. As long as you remain the way you are, you'll keep on reaching the people you have been reaching. As long as you are limited in your experience, you'll be limited in your outreach. As long as you say, I'm all right the way I am, I'm a believer already. I'm alright the way I am. I am a disciple already. And I will stay where I am. If you stay where you are, you'll keep on reaching the people you have ever been. But if you want to go beyond and reach those Jewish people, then you are going to go through the pain of growth. Growth demands pain. Because growth is leading you out of where you are into where you have not been. It's leading from what you know to what you don't know. It's leading from the people you have seen to the people you have not seen. And when you are getting to the people you have not seen and the people you have not known, you're going to go through some process of pain. And that was the circumcision of Timothy. Paul the Apostle said, you know, Timothy, and you have been in this Lystra and Iconium, and all the and this place you find that in verse 2. And the people are happy with you, and we have good reports about you. But you know what? If you move along with me, you are going to go to places you have never, never gone. And because of that, I'm going to stretch you. And the stretching is going to cause pain. You are going to be circumcised. And Timothy looking ahead. Because this pain is for a purpose. Have you ever heard this sentence before? No gain, no pain, no gain. If there is no pain, there's not going to be any gain. If you are going to be stretched, if we are going to move, if we are going to expand, if we are going to get to the regions beyond, if we are going to reach the people you have never reached, you want to gain. There must be pain, no gain. And that's the reason why Timothy submitted himself to the circumcision. And then we're told in verse 3, he with Paul had to go forth with him. He wanted Timothy to go along with him. That was a process of training. You see, this authority, a proper training for church edification. And this Timothy, by the way, let's look at the way he even believed that he came to the Lord and he believed in the Lord. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, we're looking at verse 5. And then you will see how he had believed on the Lord, how he came to know the Lord. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. When I call to remembrance, they'll think faith, on pretending faith, on hypocritical faith, the real faith, the genuine faith, the true faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice. And I am persuaded that in thee also the grandmother believed, and the mother believed too. And then they were carrying out the ministry at home, and they brought up Timothy to know the Lord. And isn't that a great ministry for mothers and grandmothers? That as you bring your children into this world, you also bring them into the kingdom of God. That you are able to pass on the faith and the word of God that brings salvation. In fact, if you look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, and from a child, thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Timothy had known the word of God, and not just known the historical word, not just knew the letter of the word, but he knew the word of God that made him wise unto salvation. And so this Timothy eventually followed after Paul the apostle. As we go back to 2 Timothy chapter 1 from verse 13, hold fast the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. Now when Timothy began to follow Paul, he wasn't just following, he was learning. And Paul the apostle said over here, you hold fast to the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me. If you are a Timothy, already God has brought you here. And if you might be a lady, you might be a man, but you are a child of God. You are not born again. Maybe you are not even born again in this church. You are born again before you knew this church. But the Lord brought you here to raise you up like a Timothy. Timothy had been born again before Paul the apostle met him. And Timothy had known the Lord, had even been a disciple, even was well reported of the believers in Lystra and Iconium before Paul met him. But all the same, any time and every time that Paul the apostle referred to Timothy, he said, my son in the faith, my son in the faith. He took him as a son. And it's like he got much more from Paul the apostle than he ever got from his mother, than he ever got from his grandmother, than he ever got from all the believers that had known him before Paul the apostle met him. And when you come to a church like this, where you have the privilege of being taught, where you have the privilege of receiving the word of God, if you are going to be useful to the Lord and you are thinking of your future in the gospel, your future in the ministry, every opportunity you have, you want to be able to take so that you can grow in the Lord. I am a Timothy, and that's my Paul, that's my mentor, that's my leader. And even though I was born again before I knew him, yet he's my pastor right now, and it's the Paul is my Paul, and he's teaching me, and then I'm holding fast to the things that I've learned. Then it says that the things which thou hast heard of me in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus, in verse 14, that good thing which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. Paul the apostle actually chose that man and trained him. And then he got him to actually do the work of the Lord. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 1. That therefore, my son, we'll see here, and Paul the apostle was not, thinking, after all, he had been born again before, and he came born again. There are some people that all the time, they're still looking back. I got born again, I changed such and such. I got born again at this particular time, and I wasn't even a member of this church at that time when I was born again. So and so is my father in the Lord. He led me to the Lord. They have not forgotten. But Timothy was called upon to forget the past. Now Paul the apostle has selected him. I haven't found him and been recommended to him. And then Paul the apostle said, do you have any other father? Do you have any other mentor? Do you have any other leader?